I'd like to invite you now to turn your attention to our next video tribute for our second honoree, Anthony Braxton.
I had always found myself the odd guy out, because many of the things I was interested in were not universally shared. I have no idea what my life would have become had I not discovered music. It would be very different from what has transpired. As a young guy, I was a Baptist, Methodist, Catholic. I got baptized in all three. I went to Zen Buddhism. I was an atheist. I went to Scientology later, only to discover that actually the house of music was what I was looking for, and that I was in the center of what I was looking for all along. The Association for the Advancement of Creative Musicians, the AACM, was a mystical gathering of men and women. It was one of the best things that had ever happened to me, to discover this group of incredible musicians. No one worked, nobody had any money. We all come from poverty. And no one would give an inch with respect to their aesthetics and their music. We believed in the music. The recordings for Arista began in 1974. They were building a new label. And so it was very exciting. I was able to do projects that were not considered quote unquote jazz. And this was very important for me, because by 1974, I had a real understanding of what my interests were. And my interests were never idiomatic. My interests were trans-idiomatic. I love the tradition, whether it's the Michigan State Marching Band, whether it's the great work of Johnny Mathis. My work is only possible because of what I've learned from the great artists who've come before me. Tradition, in my opinion, says this has all been done, and you need to learn the fundamentals and respect the last 2,000, 3,000 years of documented music, but don't let that be an excuse to not find your own work.
Now to say a few words about Anthony Braxton, I'd like to welcome 2010 NEA Master, Jazz Master, Muhal Richard Abrams.
Thank you, Soledad, and thanks to you. I'm honored to have been asked to create this brief introduction for Anthony Braxton. I met Anthony in Chicago in the mid-1960s. We were, and still are, members of a musical family called the AACM, the Association for the Advancement of Creative Musicians. In the early days, we spent many hours composing and performing each other's music. During the ensuing years, we all developed and expanded according to our individual musical perspectives. Anthony's exemplary contribution to the field of music is well documented on recordings and by literary scholars who chronicle the activities of creative musicians. So I'm going to modulate this preamble to its highlight by introducing you, or rather presenting to you, NEA 2014 Jazz Master Anthony Braxton.
I would like to thank the National Endowment of the Arts for this honor. Boy, was I surprised when Mr. Brown telephoned me several times in our conversation. I said, "Well, sir, are you thinking of Anthony Barton or maybe Anthony Jones?" I mean, for the last 50 years, my work has been viewed as not jazz, not black, not contemporary classical music. My work doesn't swing. After a while, I got used to that. I got used to those perspectives and accepted it. In the end, I just wanted to do my music. And suddenly, with the beautiful passage of time, there would be a change. And of course, there would be a change because change is a natural part of progressionalism. I grew up on the South Side of Chicago, right at the end of World War II, began to listen to the great music of my first hero, Frankie Lyman and the Teenagers. And from there, I saw the movie Blackboard Jungle and then Bill Haley in the comments. And I remember telling myself, I can't get any better than this. Meanwhile, growing up in Chicago, watching the Jack Parr show, and there would be like a 5-minute switch from WMBQ at the time, going back to the NBC network. In that 5-minute space, they would play the music of the great master Ahmad Jamal. And suddenly I'm listening to the Ahmad Jamal Trio playing But Not For Me, and I'm thinking, wow, what is this? Life could not get any better than this. A couple of years later, I had an opportunity to go to Harold Jones's parents' home. They were working. We used to go to Harold's apartment. And so suddenly I'm there with my lady, and there's a fantasy record. It's a red record. I look at the cover. I said, wow, these guys look like professors. What is this? I'm not interested in this. The LP was the Dave Brubeck Quartet at the College of the Pacific. I put on the record, the first composition was All the Things You Are. It lasted for something like 10 minutes. And when the composition was finished, My whole life had changed in that 10-minute period. And so, hooray, hooray for composite existence and the cosmic forces. Thinking about the time and space of the 50s, nationalistic musics, rejoicing in the nationalistic music, whether it's Frank Sinatra, Johnny Mathis, emergence of Motown. In the time space of the 60s, suddenly everything changed, and we began to experience the music of Ravi Shankar, global musics and global music logics. More and more, it became clear to me that music was not going to simply be a hobby or an outlet for something that would be entertaining, but rather music was part of a spiritual discipline, because this is what I was looking for. I was looking for myself, to understand myself, and I was looking for a way to understand those who are not myself, and I was looking to understand the community that I was born in. And so in the 60s, coming back from the Army after experiencing the great music of Roscoe Mitchell and Joseph Jarman at Wilson Junior College and Henry Threadgill, more and more it was becoming apparent to me that music was not going to be some kind of offshoot something, some kind of tangent component, but rather this was going to be the essence of what I wanted my life to be about. When I think about the time and space of the 1960s, I think about the change from idiomatic to trans-idiomatic components. What am I saying? I'm saying more and more the discovery of global musics would help me to understand, one, how incredible music is and how miraculous being alive is. And it would be at that point that I would make a decision to embrace music as a life's purpose, as a spiritual purpose. I had the good fortune to have my cousin Rafiki bring me to Lincoln Center to experience the work of the AACM. And suddenly, for the first time in my life, I met a group of people who understood me and what I was interested in. I tell you, it was really far out. And so for a period of 3, 4, 5 years working with this group, I was able to begin the journey of learning about myself, learning about music. Even today, when I think of myself, I refer to my work and myself as I am a professional student of music. I'm not interested in the finished product. I'm interested in doing the best that one can do in the moment. In the time space of the 60s, there was much talk about freedom. When I attempted my first solo concert, I came to that with understanding that, oh, freedom, freedom, free at last. After 5 minutes, freedom was not working. And I found myself thinking, the last thing I'm interested in is existential freedom. And so it would be at that point where my so-called music would start to come together. And it would come together based on the creation of a different set of fundamentals, fundamentals that would be trans-idiomatic fundamentals that could be used to evolve a position. And so in the beginning, in the early period, starting with the number zero, applied definition concepts, using numerology, chess moves, different ways of factoring pitch decisions. Two, syntax, the decision to develop a solo music would give me the opportunity to better understand vocabulary based on my role models and heroes. And I should also say about those role models, I'm a Paul Desmond guy. I'm a Warren Marsh guy. I am a Cecil Taylor guy. And I love the great music of the University of Michigan Marching Band. I'm a John Philip Sousa kind of guy. And so the challenge for me was to erect a language that could serve my needs, that could help me express what I was hearing. And so two, syntax, three, ornamentation logics, four, sequential logics, five, intervallic logics, six, sound mass logics, seven, short sounds or quick sounds, that the concept of the quote-unquote glimpse, all the way up to the number 12. By the 1970s, I had arrived at what I now talk about as a tricentric thought unit construct as a way to talk of the evolution of the music system, the evolution of the philosophic system, and the evolution of the ritual and ceremonial system. I felt then and now, like many of my colleagues from the Association for the Advancement of Creative Musicians, that it was important to evolve a position because everything was changing, and that evolution and restructural design is natural in every other discipline. And in fact, sometimes we tend to forget that before Charlie Parker played his music, it didn't exist. Charlie Parker, as a creative-friendly experiencer, would demonstrate an extended understanding of the fundamentals in his time space. And so, by the 1970s, it was clear to me what I wanted to do. I wanted to build a tri-centric model that would demonstrate multiple hierarchic possibilities as opposed to mono-hierarchic possibilities. And I wanted to build an imaginary world that would give me the opportunity to reintegrate narrative structures in the music. The first 20 years or so of my work, I looked at propositional logics, how to evolve repetitive logic structures, pulse track structures. Something like 15 or 20 years ago, I discovered that for me, intellectual decisions are great, but I wasn't interested in that. I was looking for something else. That was true, even though, let's face it, I was a child of Arnold Schoenberg, Karlheinz Stockhausen, Yannis Xenakis, and John Cage as well. And so the next stage of the evolution of my model
would involve the holistic models, starting with the ground floor of the ghost trance musics. I would find myself taking classes on the great music of the Native Americans, their ghost dance musics, for instance. And I discovered that rather than intellectual interesting, I was really interested in spiritualism and the spiritual components that underlie the music, rather than how clever the intellectual components could be. And so starting with the ghost trance musics, I would begin to compose the new holistic models that could be used to generate interaction, dynamics, and responses. At this point, two-thirds of the holistic generating models are completed, and my hope is in the next decade or so, depending upon what time I have left on the planet, I'd like to put the complete components of the system in place. Triaxium, philosophy, music system, ritual and ceremonial system. I felt, and the members of the AACM felt, that it would be very important to build something for the future so that what we've learned from the great masters in the past can continue to go forward, not just with stylism, which I respect. In fact, when I think about the great discipline of music, I think of the wonder of traditionalism, the wonder of stylism, and the wonder of restructuralism. And so it would be at that point that I would begin to look for new models and look for new ways to express myself. The most important thing being, I wanted to be involved in a music that kept my interests. And from that point, to evolve the kind of structures that hopefully could result in the kind of interaction dynamics that might yield a surprise, because I'm looking for a surprise. I've always needed a sonic surprise that could help me to continue to want to live, not just to be alive, but to be aware of how miraculous it is, this thing that we call being alive. And so from that point, I've tried to evolve my work and stay on a particular path. In the end, most of the musician composers in this area of the music make no money. This is not a money decision, then or now. I thank the cosmic forces that I was able to discover music, something that I could give myself to totally. And I can't believe that the cosmics allowed me to live to 68 years old. Wow. And so, hooray, hooray for the United States of America. I love the United States of America. I'm grateful that I was born a citizen of our great country. I believe in the power of creativity and the power of creativity to affect motivation, creativity to affect alignment, creativity as part of a holistic ceiling pattern that helps us to understand one another and community. There is so much work to do. And for the young people who might hear me tonight, I would say, you know, go for whatever it is that you've discovered about yourself, if it's positive and not trying to harm anyone. Do your best in life, because what we call being alive is really a very quick moment. It doesn't seem like it, especially when you're younger, but in fact, you're alive and suddenly you're not alive. And while you're alive, do your best. And so I would like to say, I'd like to say thank you to the National Endowments of Art. I would like to say hooray, hooray for music. Hooray for the cosmic forces. Hooray for our country. And the great discipline of music continues to go forward in many different kinds of forms. I'm here tonight with Dave Liebman. We're old friends. Everyone likes to pretend that, oh, Braxton's way over here and Liebman's way over here. No. We're old friends. We have different interests because we're different people. But everybody is working to do their best. The award of the Jazz Masters is a profound honor. It's understood that the men and women of the Jazz Masters group, their work has provided a vibrational factor that has helped define present-day reality. What an honor to go from the spy who's out in the cold to a guy whose work can be brought back into the family, whose work can be brought back into the community. I thank the cosmic forces for the fact that I was able to have a life and to find something that really means everything to me. I would pay people to listen to my music. This is not a money thing at all. And so as a guy who was a fan of the Sons of the Pioneers, as a guy who is a post-Scott Joplin kind of guy, I would like to say to the National Endowment of the Arts, wow, wow, this was a surprise. And I'd like to hope that inside of this surprise is a reconcilement. We need to have a reconcilement, not just in the music, but in our country. We find ourselves in this time period as a country in a complex kind of way. And I have no doubt that we will go through this period and continue to move forward because our country is a great country. Having the opportunity to work with our young people for 28 years, I can tell you this much. We continue to have the talent. We continue to have the dedication. I can't believe how brilliant each generation seems to be. And they're just moving forward. We have the goods. I'd like to hope in the future that the political arena can elevate itself and be reminded of what that role really is. We need to bring our country back together. This is not the 1900s where America was 100 years ahead in technology and all possibilities, but rather the world is changing because change is the law. Maybe we have come to a point in time where we need to reconcile the polarities, find a way to work together. Whatever happened to civility? Whatever happened to being nice and doing your best and not beating someone over the head because they're doing something different? We need to find a way, as the Egyptian mystics would say, the unity of opposites, to bring things together as we get ready for the new challenges in the third millennium. And so I would like to say thank you to the National Endowment of the Art, with a special emphasis for Mr. Brown. Having a chance to meet him in person has real meaning for me. I'd like to hope that in the course of life, there might be an opportunity to see this guy again, take him out to lunch or something. We have so many positive spirits in America. We kind of take it for granted, but maybe we shouldn't take it for granted. We have people who come from goodwill, who are ready to apply themselves to whatever the challenge is. And the wonderful discipline of music helps to enable all kinds of positive possibilities. And so I would just say, hooray, hooray, hooray. And thank you very much.
And now to play an excerpt from his composition, Trillium J. Please welcome Taylor Ho Bynum on cornet, Mary Halverson on guitar, Ingrid Lawbrook on saxophone and on vocals, Ann Rhodes and Vince Vincent.
Stanford, I declare, it is always a pleasure to be in your good company, kind sir. What in heaven's name brings you to our humble mansion on this steamy summer afternoon?
As you know, Scarlett, I have watched you as a little girl and followed your education and a bright pedigree. From the very beginning, there was no doubt that you were both bold and exceptional, like a mint julep on a summer night. The concept of affinity inside number two is not separate from the components of experience and change. And lady, you have most certainly demonstrated evolution. It is for that reason I have made this perilous journey of a fortnight through the wilderness over the kind of terrain that begs for attention. Possibilities of the next time cycle as we move into Attention! I have come here to ask for your hand in sacred matrimony so that we can respond to the rebuilding of our troubled region. Believe me, Miss Scarlet, I have the kind of coins that can guarantee loyalty and perseverance.
And complexity. As my daddy, bless his heart, used to say, the concept of affinity insight number two is not limited to non-project participation that impairs extended form building and or non-binding contractual disputes. This subject is not about the opposition's understanding of composite relationships, but rather, what are the components that demonstrate consistent evolution and vibrational movement? Why, I'm just a helpless maiden who happens to own 400 nuclear weapon stockpile containers, not to mention the chemical gas warfare options. Why, it was only yesterday I was thinking we could use a little more hired help around here. To run a 4,000-acre plantation is a time-consuming hardship, my dear.
Our union will become the basis for a renewal effort that will change the face of this region. You won't believe the kind of society balls we'll have.
What about the horses?
No problem.
What about the harvest?
No problem.
What about fence mending?
No problem.
Why, Colonel, you are a gentleman and a scholar.
The concept of affinity insight number two means nothing if the political dimensions of an effort is taken for granted. Already I can smell the magnolias in bloom on a summer's day. Not to mention the slaughter I will personally initiate to bring about target alignment variables. Look at it this way, my dear. Happy days will be here again, but happy nights will not be here again. With a little luck, the internal solutions will kick in the kind of dynamics my enemies will recognize and start migration patterns in the right direction.
What about the yarn spinning machines?
No problem.
What about old machinery replacements?
This can be solved very quickly, my love.
What about image logic devices and the new codes?
Believe me, the talkies have only just arrived, and the very first product will set the standard for decades to come.
Sir, I think you have a deal.
Thank you very, very much. Much earlier this evening, the A.B. Spellman Award was bestowed upon Mr. Jamey Aebersold. Now it's time to meet the man whose name bears this honor. A poet, scholar, music historian, author, arts administrator, and tireless advocate for jazz, please join me in welcoming the man himself, Mr. A.B. Spellman.
A lot of brilliance left the music this year. Masters left us who have elevated our minds for so long that we thought they'd never exit the stage. Isn't there a band somewhere with Cedar Walton at the heart of it? Is Donald Byrd in that band? Isn't Jim Hall going to join us up here on the stage with his deep and subtle strings? Won't Miriam McPartland open our Saturday morning on NPR this week with conversations and duets with her peers? Is the elegant and eloquent Frank Wess her guest this week? And didn't I hear that Chico Hamilton has a new grouping of instruments that will alter the sound of the jazz bands forever? And Yusef Lateef must be working on the next extension of the jazz medium somewhere. Well, we are saved by the fact that we have their records to sustain us. Otherwise, we'd have a huge hole in our souls, wouldn't we? Tonight, we celebrate their lives and we mourn their deaths. To help us remember, two great masters, Kenny Barron and Jimmy Owens, will join us to play Frank Wess's Placitude.
Thank you very much. All of those seven jazz masters mean something very special to Kenny Barron and Jimmy Owens. We interacted with each of them in the more than 50 years that we've been dealing with this music. Donald Byrd was my teacher when I was 14 years old. Yusef Lateef acted as the teacher for a group that he had that Kenny Barron was very, very involved in. Chico Hamilton was someone I just finished doing a recording of his music. Frank Wess, Kenny Barron just finished recording his last album. So this Frank Wess composition, Placitude, is dedicated to all seven.